Well, good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this great event. And so I would like to apologize that I have to leave tomorrow at noon. I really don't like to be a person who comes and goes after their talk, but my daughter is graduating from high school, so I cannot miss the graduation ceremony. I'm sorry about that. So I think in this talk, I will try to contribute to your notions about linguistic diversity and cognition from a multimodal viewpoint. So I will make things even more complicated, given the fact that human language can be expressed not only in vocal and auditory vocal modalities and through text, but also through the bodily articulators, that's through the visual modality. So we will see how this affects all the ideas about linguistic diversity that we have to deal with. So there are a lot of assumptions in psycholinguistics, neurolinguistics even, and linguistics that language is composed of combinatorial units of four meaning mappings that are arbitrary, stable, and shared across speakers, and that they are these four meaning mappings are homogeneous. For example, if A wants to talk about a soap, like where can I buy soap, so a meaning has to be encoded in this assumption to an arbitrary sound unit and which needs to be decoded by the listener. And these models are already, kind of assumed in a lot of also in large language models and how they are encoded and decoded in the brain recently, and they are becoming even more and more common, I think. However, we know that these four meaning mappings are not as homogeneous as we think and stable as we think they are. They are mostly ambiguous, and they might not necessarily be shared similarly across individuals at a given moment. So somebody might think of a bar soap when he means utters the word soap, but the other person might be thinking of a liquid soap. So I would like to give you an example from an attraction that I encountered in our summer house in south of Turkey, Bodrum. So this really happened. I went to a pharmacy and the person in front of me, a customer, she wanted to really buy soap, and not soap, but soap. And she was talking to two different pharmacists, and then she comes to the scene and then she asks, do you have soap, with this gesture. And then B turns to see the other pharmacist, says, do we have soap? But he doesn't use gesture, talking to the other pharmacist. And the other pharmacist, like C, says to B, yes, we have soap, but she points to a bar soap. And C has not seen A's gesture. And then B says to C, oh, she means soap, with this gesture again. So now the pharmacist repeats the patient's, the liquid soap gesture. And then C understands what kind of soap is meant, and then she points again to the soap and says, yes, we have it. And now the ambiguous soap is disambiguated. And as you see, this would not have been possible without this simultaneous, what we call an iconic gesture, that would be a gesture about how you act with an object, and then we would use it for the object, for example. So, this interaction and dissolving ambiguity of soap had to be accompanied with this iconic gesture. And also, we see that there was a cross-speaker multimodal repetition that kind of made two people converge on what kind of soap we are talking about. So let's take all these visuals out, and then what do we see? Do we have soap? Do we have soap? Yes, we have soap. She needs soap. Okay. So then, obviously, without iconic and pointing gestures, joint attention, and unfolding of interactive terms, it is impossible to understand what the intended reference of soap is. And to me, this seems like a conversation with ChatGPT. And, of course, the new version of ChatGPT 4.0 is video trained, but we have tried the version that it cannot understand what a pointing gesture is and so on. So I think it will take a really, really a long time for these large language models to have a real conversation and multimodally. So why does it matter? I think it matters if we think of language as an adaptive system. So language has adapted to individual variations, contexts, and cultures over time. So this was the case in the past, is the case in the present. So it has, language has adapted to all human societies we know around the world, and it is, adapting to new technologies that we have. And it's only recently that we can actually use language with non-humans. So this is a historical change, and we have to see how our language practices will change as a result of this. And probably language will also keep adapting when we move to new planets. I would like to claim that the multimodal expressibility of language is key to its adaptivity. So we can express language, of course, with speech and localizations, but also we constantly see other people's lips movement. We can use our hands and body in using language at all times, and we can also use our eyes, face expression, and head nods in moving in different ways that have relevant linguistic features. And of course, when we write, we used to just write text, but now when the technology allows, we know that we are combining, text with lots of visual emojis, pictures, and even videos that we see in TikTok, for example. So language, when language allows, the technology allows, we like to use all modalities. So then I think this is a universal feature of human language, that is its multimodal expressivity and diversity. So when we look at the, face-to-face uses of language, where human evolution started, we know that all hearing communities around the world, they use hand gestures, head gestures, facial gestures when they speak. So we have not encountered any language that uses speech only. So there is not a, evolutionary path where, language started with gestures, they turned into speech and gestures dissolved. And all that language, the hearing is not accessible, all deaf communities around the world can create language in the form of using body visual articulators alone. And these sign languages have all linguistic structures that we know of the spoken languages and maybe more. So what is interesting is that, again, no language community uses speech only, but all languages use a visual modality one way or another. So then it's really interesting to see that linguistics as a field has mostly focused on the speech characteristics that are mostly written, but has ignored a lot of the aspects of linguistic structures that human language has on visual structures. So this is the visual aspects have been ignored in the field of linguistics because there are a lot of modality-specific structures in visual forms of language. For example, both spoken languages and sign languages, they can have pointing gestures or pointing signs. Is pointing? No, I cannot point. Okay, I have talked about pointing without pointing. But okay. So these are a universal feature of we can point to objects in our surroundings, but we can also point to abstract spaces in front of us. Speakers can use iconic gestures that look like the objects and events that they refer to. For example, somebody can say she opened a jar by acting like opening a jar. And in sign languages, there are also lexical signs that are iconic. So these constitute kind of like two-thirds of all sign language lexicons, for example. This would mean house in many sign languages. Another modality-specific feature is simultaneity. So if you have two hands and a body, so you are likely to use all of them at the same time. For example, if somebody is carrying a box, then you have to use both hands. And you're also using your gestures together with speech, so there's a lot of simultaneity going on, whereas traditional spoken language research has paid attention only to the sequentiality and sequential structures. And again, simultaneity is very common form in sign languages where the body, two hands, can be used, especially when people are expressing event components, motion events, spatial language. So these are the main areas where simultaneity is used. So what's interesting is that all these speeches are hard to represent in text. So anytime you have to write it, you know, for future generations, you know, this is not easy to write because text is, again, 2D and sequential. So we lose a lot of aspects of the human language that we think is at the periphery, but actually they are in the center. But because we cannot represent in text, we tend to ignore them in our language and grammars. So then the traditional approaches have ignored these inherently multimodal diversity aspects of language. So what has been linguistic is considered as what can be spoken and written, what the arbitrary form meaning mappings, the categorical discrete features of forms of language, and it has been mostly languages considered to be expressible in a linear and unichannel format. However, on the other hand, the visible body that goes along with spoken and sign languages, iconic and indexical characteristics of these semiotic expressions, analog and ingredient for meaning mappings, and the simultaneous aspects have been ignored. So in many, you know, traditional ways of talking about languages evolving and so on, for example, iconic gestures and pointing are seen as proto-language. Also, unfortunately, Thomas Hall's models as well, and I've asked him many times about this. And language has, or language has been viewed as an A-model system where none of this really matters. So that approach, the A-model language approach, also ignores the, you know, the visual aspects of language and the semiotic expressivity. In the multimodal view of language that I'm trying to, you know, advocate is that all these two aspects of language should be considered into one language model. The reason for this, I think, is that a semiotically diverse linguistic system combining affordances of each modality is more flexible and adaptive to any individual cognitive variations, to different contexts, noise, and age groups, and so on and so forth. So all the, because people can combine all these things, these two characteristics have curtailed, so they are not going away, you know, in languages, but they have stayed over time and years. You know, in sign languages, iconicity don't go away through evolution. It still sticks. So, but there's a reason, I think, for that these characteristics are staying. So this kind of idea of language, we have also, you know, written a theoretical article kind of extending Jenkins' language parallel architecture model to multimodality. It's a theoretical article if you would like to read, I recommend it. And there's been a new book by Neil Kahn, a multimodal language faculty, where he also extends these models to use of emojis and pictures together with speech on text. So then, in order to say that all these modality-specific aspects are part of language system, of course, this is the big claim, but in the last 20 years of my life, I have shown that, in language production, communicative interactions, language transmission, in acquisition or emergence of new languages, language comprehension and neuroprocessing and cognition, these aspects of language are part of the language system. So today I'll briefly talk about these two. So first of all, language production without gesturing is very difficult. So a while ago there was a movie about multimodal language, and the movie makers, they asked some students in Ghent to explain how to make a chocobus without gesturing and see what they came up with. This is in Dutch, but you will understand the difficulty they have.
Indacht en geduld getoond en een recept voor hele schoenen. De groepjes gaan er niet in werken, want het bleef aan de tafel. Ze krijgen veel kennis in, waarin de vier sterren hebben verteld hoe ze schoenen zullen maken. Daarna wil ze proberen zo goed mogelijk te laten vertellen wat ze gezien hebben.
We nemen fondant chocolade, we steken de chocolade in brokjes en we laten die smelten.
Vervolgens zoek je ook nog met.
Inderdaad, braden wordt aanzienlijk moeilijker.
En dan moet je de eier doorvoeren naar de. Alleen naar het half schelp in.
Ze proberen toch gewaagd te maken.
Ja, zo wat. Jongeren tussen de twee eierschalen.
Desnoods maak je wagen met uw hoofd.
En dan doen we het ei met ook wat zakjes om.
En volgens mij was de jargon is dan klaar.
Spreken zonder je handen te gebruiken is dus blijkbaar niet evident.
Was het?
Okay, so this is the simplest way I can show that gesturing is part of language when you speak. Another thing is when we look at different languages, like, you know, here people are interested in typologically different languages, so we know that the way people use gestures actually align with these typological differences. For example, in English, in order to talk about a cat rolling down the hill, you have to express manner and pat in one verbal clause, whereas in Japanese and Turkish, we saw from Sabine's, you know, slide that Japanese and Turkish put them together, and also in gestures we put them together. So you have to use two verbs, rolling and descent. And the gestures really parallel these patterns. English speaker talking about gesturing, about rolling down the hill of the cat, uses one gesture to express both components.
He rolls down a street into a bowling alley.
Whereas when we look at Japanese and Turkish people, they use two different gestures. So these patterns are very robust, and we tested with different types of stimuli, with different speakers, we see very similar patterns. And very interestingly, if you get a blind English speaker and a blind Turkish speaker and ask them to talk about motion events, they again use these gestural differences. So these differences are not coming from enculturation and having seen other people gesture this way. And so the Goldmanov has done a lot of work.
He rolls down.
And also when in comprehension, so we know, we have shown a lot of evidence that when people are comprehending messages from two modalities, they integrate them immediately. For example, we have shown people some kind of actions, and then we have told that we have given them later videos of speech and gesture pairs, where speech and gesture match, speech and gesture mismatch weakly, and speech and gesture mismatch strongly. So we have always asked them, oh, and what you heard, did it match the action you have seen? And we didn't mention gesture. But people made more errors and they were slower the more the gesture mismatched the speech. So it means that people are integrating automatically information from gestures. And we've also done a lot of ERB studies showing that mismatching speech and gesture evokes a more stronger N400, which is a semantic comprehension component in the brain, than matching gestures. And also we've gone ahead and looked at all the brain imaging studies and so on, and we have found that pointing gestures and iconic gestures, they are processed and integrated with spoken language in the classic language areas, the Broca's areas, the temporal areas, and the MTG. And however, there are also some, you know, modality-specific areas, the motor areas, and the visual cortex, of course, gets more activated if semantic integration is needed with visual information. So then, you know, as a result, I would like to propose that, you know, we have to think about a multimodal view of language where we have to think of all spoken languages and sign languages we are studying expressible in multiple modalities in a multimodal system. And we can start doing our typologies again, new. So, you know, when we think of multimodal lexicons, and I think in the highlighting there was something about, you know, the yesterday and tomorrow being the same word, but gestures accompanying and disambiguating it. So this would be a like perfect example for me. Okay, well, there are multimodal lexicons in the domain of negation, demonstratives, word order, prosody, so on and so forth. And I've already done research on some of these things, and these cross-linguistic multimodal typologies really do exist. So then, let's say this is our language system, and I would, in this model, the ways of communicative interaction, of course, shapes these multimodal grammars, you know, in ways that I think Sabine was also talking about, as well as the neurobiology, cognitive and learning constraints. So there are, you know, bidirectional constraints from human cognition and biology on the one hand, and the communicative interaction constraints that are culturally dependent that shape these multimodal packages. Just to give you an idea how this would look like, for example, in spoken Turkish, which is a verb final language, and then the negation comes after the verb. For example, that man kissed not. I did not kiss that man. And this is usually accompanied with a negation gesture like this. But the gesture comes before the negation morpheme. So it looks like kiss not. Okay? So people already know that a negation is coming. And this gesture doesn't mean no. It doesn't mean anything by itself. I think it's a gestural morpheme. So it accompanies the Turkish negation morpheme. When we look at English, for example, English uses head shakes usually for negation, and it also has this kind of negation gesture. It has been studied already. But in English, so the negation head shake and the movement of the hands come on the verb, and so in English, not comes before the verb, unlike Turkish, and the gesture also starts on the not. So if I don't stay here, I do not have to pay. So this is a very different typological pattern than Turkish, where gesture is coming before, but in English, gesture is coming during the verb, and the scope starts with not and moves towards the verb. When we look at, for example, Turkish sign language, again, Turkish sign language also uses the same sign, this time, to negate, and it also comes after the verb. So, I speak not. Okay? So there are a lot of similarities, but still a typological difference. And when we look at American sign language also uses head shakes, like the spoken language, and the head shake comes on the verb. So I understand not. So I don't understand. So the head shake comes together with the verb, like the English version. So then, we can think of some kind of, across spoken and sign languages, typologies of sign language, but this time taking the gestures seriously into account. So in a lot of models of gestures and signs, these gestures have been seen as precursors of sign languages. So there's an evolution of from gesture to sign. But I would like to claim that actually the gestures in the spoken language system of negation, they are also part of the grammatical structures. And actually, to prove this, we are doing some EEG studies where people are seeing this negation gesture with the negation morpheme, and then see if the brain processes the gesture and the word in the same way. And we just look like, because we are using avatars. Okay, I'm almost done. And also, finally, I would like to say that in order to do this work, multimodal language typologies, we have to analyze a lot of data, and it's not easy. You cannot do this by manually. So we are developing automatic recognition techniques where the gestures can be segmented, the size, velocity, and the location of the gestures and signs can be automatically extracted, including the face and the hands. So we use OpenPOSE and MediaPipe methods. And in this way, we can also go towards distributional semantics based on vectors in gesture, sign, and in speech and text, so that we can have a common representational format to write models of grammars across domains. And finally, we have built a bicon motion capture lab at the MPI Institute for Psycholinguistics, where we are tracking all body parts while people are talking, and these models will serve to use them in virtual reality so that we can test some of these theories in 3D while people are talking with the avatars. So this is a very short segment. We just, we are opening it in 2 days at the MPI.
I was having a bowl of yogurt with apples, so I chopped some apples and I chopped some nuts, put them into a bowl, made stew.
So here you can see that all the finger movements and the motion can be exactly 3D one-to-one represented, and we can put these avatars into a 3D VR settings. So then, all in all, conclusions, I'm sorry, multimodality is a fundamental design feature of language, and I think that made it an adaptive system. And many old and new models of language, large language models, ChatGPT, and psychoneural linguistics currently are based on speech and text as representing the human language system. However, I think we need to widen our lines of language to include all semiotic expressive possibilities of each modality in studying language. So considering multimodal diversity, and I hope this can be also your take-home message, in cross-linguistic diversity will provide us an inclusive, also we can include more signers and speakers around the world, inclusive and comprehensive view of human language capacity and its adaptive nature. So new technologies such as multimodal LLMs, automatic motion capture and recognition will allow us to study this in unprecedented ways. So I think future is multimodal. And thanks to my department at the FBI and our little robot, the full edge robot that we are working with. Thank you.